A Beginner's Guide to the Universe. Uncommon ideas for living an unusually happy life. Mike Dooley. To Rebecca Solosito Dooley. Before this odyssey ever began, there was you, your best friends, and wide-eyed curiosity among you about who would be the first to leap, the first to forget, the first to kiss, the first to tell, the first to fall, the first to get back up, and the first to remember that living in the illusions of time and space all began with a dare. To love in spite of it all. Prologue. The Man You Think I Am. Dearest Rebecca, the phone call I'll never forget came late afternoon at home. It was the weekend. I was sitting at the desk in my office, your mother across from me. A nurse began, "You want to know the sex?" "What?" "You and your wife are having a baby," she explained patiently, "and you want to know the sex?" "Yes, right." Without a hint of emotion, she continued, "You're going to have a girl." It was as if God had just spoken. This reality check of our firstborn about to arrive, when I was 52 years of age, soon to be 53, seemed more authentic than the modestly increased curvature of your mother's belly. A girl! My entire life, while outwardly nonchalant about having kids at all, I'd sometimes allow myself to imagine having a daughter. Of course, by my age, it seemed this boat had already sailed. And then you arrived, 6 weeks early, evading the 25% chance you had, based on your mom's and my genetics, of having full-blown cystic fibrosis. You're 5.5 pounds, turning our family of two into three. Your mother's existence and mine about to be transformed in ways unimaginable. Never mind that we'd been warned of this by every parent who's ever lived. Even today, my greatest surprise over your presence in our lives is how surprised I've been by everything. As I held you the very first time, your searching eyes belied a depth not apparent in your extremely small, frail body. This window to your soul gave no hint of where you've been, the plans you've made, or who you might become. Your tiny limbs and quivering voice were angelic. I was mesmerized, which had less to do with odds beaten and digits counted, and more with your very embodiment of life's greatest mystery. How could any of this, life, you, our new family, be remotely possible? As these first years have rolled by and your fifth birthday now approaches, more than anything else, I'm awed as I witness you taking your place in the world, vessel of spirit, spark of the divine. Not as my child, you are not truly mine, but as a child of the universe. Still confounded that your mother and I somehow caused a biological chain of events far beyond our ability to grasp that would deliver you as if from heaven into our lives. That we are charged as caregivers and light bearers seems so contrarily absurd. Who are we to deserve so much? And who are we to be given so great a task? I fumble in my own darkness enough. There's not much light to spare. Yet that this madness is so, parents in the dark bringing forth children of light in a world of meticulous order, means there must be a plan and a reason for our relationship. And so I will endeavor, as all parents must, to fulfill my role and not take more from you than I'm able to give. Since your arrival, I've adored you for every reason and for none at all. And as if things could be even better, to my wild astonishment, you seem to be just as crazy about me. to the point of embarrassment as you shun others who crave your attention as much as I do. And when you reach for me in spite of their outstretched arms and open, vulnerable hearts. Has there been some cosmic mistake that I, rather than a misplaced saint, am the one so privileged to enjoy the extreme proximity of your existence and these mutual currents of adoration, punctuated with giggles and tears? If only my heart sometimes aches, I could be the man you think I am when you urgently and repeatedly call out, Daddy, 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 hundreds of times in a single day, wanting to share with me your every observation, idea, or whim. Or when you cry over my absence, want to ride upon my shoulders, or sit beside me for a meal. How could I be so important to such perfection as you? This importance is what I now strive to earn, to one day become the man you see in me, the man you think I am, and to always be a light in your darkness, hope in your despair, and the best father in the world to any degree I may. When your mom was still pregnant, I was told by a friend that your impending birth would mark the day my life would begin. And so it seems. So much so that I sometimes feel my time on earth prior to your arrival was merely preparation for what we're now experiencing and all that lies ahead. Speaking of which, while I have every expectation of loving and guiding you for decades more, I'm not so naive to think you'll hear all I say, to assume what I offer will actually be helpful, or to even be sure I'll live that long. Yet, as an author and a speaker whose notes from the universe have almost made me famous, and whose ideas have at least improved my own life, there are some things I hope to impart before this gig is up, or before we find out there really was some cosmic mistake. As if a beginner's guide to the universe. A handbook for rocking these hallowed jungles of time and space as a budding master with uncommon ideas for living an unusually happy life. Not that I'm a master, but my work the past two decades has been to help people live deliberately and create consciously among life's infinite possibilities. A la thoughts become things. My catchphrase in the film and book, The Secret. I've been teaching that life is neither a random game of chance nor a test of obedience, that we live in a world of absolute perfection made possible by love upon which we are inclined to thrive. I actually tell audiences that life is not fair, but rigged in our favor. To add some girding to these otherwise woo-woo ideas, my style and tone has always been more certified public accountant than doting father. I'm simply not used to exploring love and tenderness, which makes all that I feel for you so bizarre and tantalizing. But in spite of my actuarial tone, which I do think serves the lessons, I hope to reach both your mind and your heart. I realize, of course, most people these days don't read books, and I found this is triply true if the author is a family member, never a prophet in your hometown. In your own home? Forget it. And would you please take out the trash? That's fine. I'd rather be your dad than your guru. Still, teaching is what I've been doing and loving for 20 years. And if the things I write could possibly shorten your own learning curves, lessen future suffering, and increase future joys, I must try. In the pages that follow, there are 6 chapters covering the key tenets and concepts that I believe, once known, will give you or any reader the biggest boost possible in life. Each chapter is introduced by a letter recalling my own life's epiphanies or related memories of times recently shared together, followed by brief lessons on taking massive responsibility and its immense rewards. Finally, the epilogue will let you in on one of the most surprising discoveries I've made from compiling these ideas, perhaps even the most surprising discovery of my life, concerning the shortcoming that weighs on me most lately: not being the man you think I am. A revelation with implications for every single person who's ever lived. So, to spare you any guilt that might arise from blowing off my earlier 15 books, this single one, as simple and concise as I could make it, capturing what I'd most hope any avid reader would gain from all my books combined, is for you, and for anyone else who'd like to be reminded of life's beauty, our power, and how much we're loved. May all that you wish for be the
least. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.